realism. I've no idea what it is. It attempts to categorize work made by critics and by academics, and I can see why. But they often confuse more than they reveal to me, partly because too much is put into that category, too many different things. And people have often asked me, well, what sort of stuff do you do? And realism seemed to me to beg too many questions, which I'll come to some of them in a moment. The only phrase that I could come up with was a distilled naturalism. That is, the word naturalism is used to reveal that you're trying to show the nature of things. But the soaps can pretend they're doing that. And I despise the soaps. Not the people involved. There are some very talented people working on the soaps. And it's one of the ways in for young people to get a break. And in fact, I've hired people from the soaps. I've hired screenwriters and directors and script editors who I've promoted to be publishers, producers, and trained them up. The problem with the soaps is that they're a long way from being art. They are branches of manufacturing. Very useful for channel controllers because they're very cheap. Cost per thousand viewers, they're as cheap as chips, and that's what controllers want. But that industrial process, where they work out, they have to do this, 6 months in advance, long storyline, and then hand that over to somebody who writes up the storyline. Then hands that over to someone who writes the script, which is actually a dialogue. It's an assembly. And then they shoot it so fast, the actors have to learn how long, get on there, do it fast, do it, no more takes, off to the next scene. It's a branch of manufacturing. And what you get are shortcuts. Emotional shortcuts, narrative shortcuts, acting shortcuts, directing shortcuts. And that leads to sentimentality, which is something else I despise and have always tried to rub out of everything I had anything to do with. Occasionally failed, looking back on it, but always trying to. Sentiment is fine. I've lived off it over the years, connecting with audiences. But sentimentality is not. And sentimentality, for me, is unearned feeling. You take quick little technical shortcuts to draw a tear. Get people to sympathize. And you're telling people nothing about the world at all. So, the shallow nature of the soaps, its industrial process, its sentimentality, its surface gloss of, oh, that's the real world, isn't it? Is a lie. And it's a bit like feeding people sugar and McDonald's and nothing else. For me, it is cultural, ideological, social poison. As you can see, I've got quite strong views about it. So that's why I use the phrase distilled naturalism. So let's go into that for a minute. And I can't come to Sheffield today, after the announcement in the House of Commons yesterday, without talking about Orgreave. So, you get a report in the newspaper, a report in the news, television news, summarising what the Home Secretary, Amber Rudd, said, and summarising what one or two Labour politicians said, maybe showing even a clip. That is fact. There were no lies in that story. The television didn't tell any lies. But they didn't tell you much about it either. There was no truth there. Because facts don't really tell you the truth about anything. In order for a fact to have meaning, it must be contextualized. And it's usually contextualized into a narrative. What we do with each other, all our lives, is to tell stories. I'm not sure if that's hardwired. I'm not a neurologist. I'm not sure that it is absolutely universal because I'm not a cultural anthropologist. But it might be both. It's certainly with all of us. It's the way we make sense of the world, telling stories. And how we make sense of ourselves. And how we make sense of ourselves in the world. And everybody is telling a story. Everybody's making up a story. You did it from about the age of 18 months or two. And your parents said, I think you're telling a story. And then when you're a bit older, they said, well, that's a fib, isn't it? And a bit older than that, they said, you're lying, I don't like lies. And a few years later, if you told your lies in 80 to 100,000 words, you'd probably win the Booker Prize. Almost every ad now is a narrative. They have to find the story. Every brand has to tell you a story so that you can find yourself in the brand. And the Pentagon are big storytellers. So that you can see their view of the world through a story. You get a huge arms dump area in the United States, and when you drive up to drive in, there's a big notice, and it says, peace is our profession. It's full of nuclear weapons. And the Pentagon now is collaborating with Hollywood companies to create video games with narratives. And those video games are training armed personnel to fight. And they're persuading people to join because even the Pentagon needs a story. So Orgreave, if you were going to do a story now about Orgreave, you're going to make a film or write it up, in terms of fiction, in order to tell fact, which is what I've spent my life trying to do, you would have to know quite a lot about the role of the police and its relationship with the state. I did that with my colleagues with a mini-series in the 70s called Law and Order, which was about the Metropolitan Police. It was four films where the main assertion was that it is impossible to be a detective in the Metropolitan Police unless you are corrupt. All this bad apple in the barrel stuff, which had been going on in films since ever, where there is a corrupt policeman, usually a man. But they find him and they root him out the bad apple in the barrel to show what a good, honest force they are. That's And there was an eruption in the House of Commons. Terrible trouble in the BBC. You shouldn't be allowed to say these awful things about our boys in blue. And then about 3 years later, they appointed a new commissioner to the Metropolitan Police. And when he was appointed, he said it was his ambition to arrest more people than he employed. He didn't apologise to us. We did another police series called Between the Lines, which was about the department of the Metropolitan Police that existed to root out corruption. So this is great, because this was a very different BBC by then, and it was very difficult to get shows on the air. And once I got a green light for that, I thought, good, I can have corrupt coppers on the screen every week. Which we did. Part of the narrative, part of what the source series was about. And we ended it by finding where the real corruption was. And the most corrupt copper in the whole of the Met was someone who ran the department investigating corruption. And everybody said, particularly the PR people at the Metropolitan Police, who were much more sophisticated in those days than they were when we did Law and Order, they said, oh, well, of course, it's absolutely nothing to do with the real life, but it's an entertaining drama. And then a year or two later, the Met started a new department. And this new department's sole role was to investigate the department that was in existence to investigate corruption. Because they were so worried by the corruption in that department, they had to start another one. We didn't get the policy. And the role of the police in Orgreave was important. So you'd have to start telling some truth about the police. And you'd have to start digging and researching, although a lot of research had been done. And then you'd have to find out something about the role of the miner in those days, and traditionally. You would have to see and recognise that the miners were the most feared workers by the ruling class that this country has ever known. They were highly politicised. They were solid and loyal to each other. They had a strong trade union, and they wouldn't take shit from anybody. They were the leaders of the organised working class. So if you want to beat the organised working class up, you start with the miners and you give them a good thrashing, and that will discourage the rest. And they'd already done this in 1926 during the general strike. And the miners were out for nearly a year on the stones all on their own. Sorry. Chokes me up to even talk about it. And the leaders of the TUC washed their hands of the miners. And Ramsay MacDonald, the head of the Labour Party, said, oh dear, what a pity. We don't want this sort of trouble. So they got no help from them either. They were on their own. So Jim Allen and Ken Loach and I and a few others did a mini-series called Days of Hope, which ended with a film about the general strike in 1926. Where Baldwin's government decided to beat the miners into submission. They beat them. And in beating the miners, they beat everybody else. Nobody would dare go on strike after they'd beaten the miners. And we made that film as a warning. We said, this will happen again. If working people don't stay solid, it'll happen again. And it happened again, because in the 70s, the Keynesian solution to the problems were falling apart, and the ruling class wanted to increase their profits, and the last thing they wanted was struppy miners. And Arthur had humiliated them at Saltley a few years before, Saltley in Birmingham. He'd given Heath and the Tory government a black eye, and they never forgot it. So how can you understand Orgreave if you don't take that into account? you also have to take into account the relationship between the state and the police. Does anybody actually believe that Orgreave happened because the police wanted it to happen? The police were under direct instructions. They knew they wouldn't be blamed. Whatever they did, they could break any heads they liked because the government was telling them to do it. Now, unless you take all those things into account, how can you tell the truth? But everybody was saying, well, that's your speculation. Yes, it is, I'd say. Because my method of making, producing films was to do this. I would keep faith with the audience. I've always used the word fiction. People wanted to use documentary drama, which is often used about our films, which I hate. What kind of a bastard thing is that, documentary drama? It's fiction. We make it up. What we say to the audience is, we better look at this, this aspect of the world, this aspect of our society. We've had a good look at it, and this is our provisional view of it. What do you think? But we have made it up because there's a writer credited. There are a group of actors playing these parts. You know, it's not, we're not pretending to be a documentary. We're not pretending to be the news. This is us making it up, saying, what do you think? No, I think we keep better faith with the audience than the other people do. Documentaries. Goodness me, when I first started, the BBC was making a documentary about the royal family. These were filmmakers on their knees. But of course, in those days, the leading item in the news would be this. The Queen has a heavy cold. That's world news. It's not much different. But I was told by the news and current affairs people at the BBC that unless I changed what I did, they didn't want me there. Because they were telling the truth and I was telling lies. Of course, it didn't help much because in those days I said, the most accomplished fiction on BBC television was the 9 o'clock news. It isn't anymore. It's the 10 o'clock news. Because when you make the news every night, what do? There's a whole lot of stuff coming in from all over the world. Correspondents are wanting to tell you about what's happening here and there. Film is coming in, pouring in, and you have, what, half an hour? So you select. On what basis? You select. And then you say, well, that's a bit of a heavy item. We've got to finish with a bit of something light because, you know, we've got to keep the audience because they've got to, you know, they're in a ratings battle as well. And then they say, well, that film is really better than that boring, you know, talking head. So the film is not such an important story, but better have that film because it's really beautiful. And there are all sorts of constraints on it. And what do they bring to it? In the end, they bring their prejudices to it. And they call that balance. We are objective, we are fair, we are the news. No, they're not. They are a news. And you'd make a different news, and you'd make a different news, and so would I, if you were allowed. But of course, you can't be allowed. Because the BBC has, in the end, to do what the government wants within certain limits. I mean, they can do what they want, provided they don't really offend the government. And when they really offend the government comes in and slaps them down. This is your BBC, your independent, separate from the state BBC. If you believe that, you believe anything. But of course, the English invented hypocrisy. Examples? During the general strike of 1926, the British Broadcasting Company was starting to get a big audience. And Winston Churchill, who was in the cabinet, said, well, we'll have that. That'll be very good for our propaganda. He didn't actually say that. He said, for telling the truth about what's happening. All over the country, people were listening to it. And Baldwin, the Prime Minister, who was a much cannier class operative, said, oh, no, 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 we won't. We won't take it over. We'll leave it as it is. The public will believe it if they don't think it's ours. If they think it's ours, they'll see it as propaganda. So we got John Rees, who was the boss, and the BBC in, and he said, I'll do a deal with you. You assure us that you won't talk the strike up, that you'll be in favour of the strike ending and in favour of the government, and you can keep your independence. And John Rees said, yeah, that's a good deal. Well, his own reasoning, which he put in his memoir, was, well, we're on the side of the people and the government. The government is elected, so it's on the side of the people, so we're on the side of the government. And that was a precedent. John Rees, the Director General of the BBC, by the way, was a great admirer of Mussolini. He was a class warrior and censored all material that he didn't agree with. But the BBC was independent. Just recently, the BBC published something about the origins of the Iraq War and secrets and so on to Blair, the poor chap who gave those secrets away, committed suicide or was murdered, whatever he was, a few days later. Oh. Blair wouldn't stand for that. So the chairman of the BBC and the director and director general of the BBC resigned. Or sacked. That's how independent they are. So, realism. It's a complicated idea. If you want to understand any films, or if you want to work in films, but even if you go to films or watch television, and you want the history of it, you've got to understand two other things, because no film exists in isolation. That's an unhelpful individualist idea, an unhelpful aesthetic. You will never understand a film by just looking at the film. You've got to look at two other things. One is the changes in technology, because technology tends to predicate social and cultural change. And the changes of technology in my lifetime have been extraordinary. For instance, when I started in the business, the technology was so complex and so expensive and so difficult to deal with that only a few people owned it. Only a few people had the financial resources to use it. So you had to be invited. The cameras were huge, they were very complex, and people spent years learning how to use them. And repair them and handle them. You had to get celluloid from Kodak and thread it through the camera. You know all this stuff, push some light through it. We couldn't even get a screening of our rushes without hiring a cinema just to look at the stuff. And the editing was complex, and then it had to go to the laboratory again. This was immensely cumbersome and immensely expensive, which meant that in order to work, they wanted you to make the films that they wanted to make. That was a problem, because I wanted to make films that I wanted to make. Now, you lucky people can go down to Dixon's or get something second-hand, a point-and-shoot camera, and you get pictures. Some will be better than others, but you've got pictures. You edit on your laptop, don't you? Bang it up there, server space is cheap. So for virtually nothing you can make your films. I mean, nobody will know you're there. But people find it. These things are happening. I wish it was like that when I've been young. In fact, now, if I were your age now, if I wanted to be in the film business, I wouldn't work on television. I wouldn't scratch around trying to raise some money for the cinema. I'd work on the internet. Just like that. What we've been seeing through three generations is the democratization of filmmaking. And that is a profound cultural change. Possibly a profound political change. It's also immensely disruptive. Because in the old days, with the old technology of film, a few people could do it, but with a strong trade union, they could all earn a good living. Now, everybody can do it. And the trade unions are weak. And it's very difficult to get a living from. Part of the transformation of the internet, which is proceeding faster and faster and faster. And of course, we have a system which can't quite cope with that. Another system, one that Marx envisaged, would be a possibility for us all to become truly human. Because the machines would do most of the work, and we'd be loving each other, caring for each other, becoming artists. Why should the artist be just one small group who sort of does it for us? You look at any little child, 2 or 3 years of age, you watch them give a little bit of cardboard box or something, and within 5 minutes, these little children are creating the most amazing narratives in their fantasies. They're going to Mars, they're doing all sorts of things. They'll change their narrative and do something else. You don't have to do anything, just watch them. And it's magical. Because all little children are creative. They're artists. But of course you have to knock that out of them. I can't live with that. And so they get into their teens and more and they say, well, I can't do that, so I'm not very creative. You have a world where everyone is. Well, when I was young, I used to think, well, we'll have a revolution come Friday. And I thought I'd do it personally. No film ever changed anything. That's the problem. No film that I've ever had anything to do with has changed anything. I'm going around the country now talking about Cathy Come Home, a film we made in 1966 because it's the 50th anniversary. And it's being watched now, all over. There's a show in Bristol on Sunday, there'll be another showing soon. Someone else, I've even forgot where it was, but keep bringing me up. It didn't change anything. Virtually nothing, anyway. I'll tell you what the biggest change that happened as a result of Cathy Come Home. Ken Loach and I now have a very nice place to live in. I'm ashamed that that film is being shown now. Ashamed. It ought to be in an archive somewhere for maybe film students to look at now and again, or academics. It's a little film shot in 3 weeks on a tiny, tiny budget. Black and white, rough film. I mean, I had some very talented people working with me. But it's only being shown now because there are more people homeless now and the housing situation is worse now than it was 50 years ago. That's how much Cathy Come Home changed. What you can hope to do with a film sometimes is to raise consciousness, draw people's attention to something, get them emotionally involved so they care about others they actually don't want to walk by on the other side. It reminds them that they are their brother's keeper. That's all. But it won't change them. Films also had to be judged by the political and social context in which they were made. Because in order to make a film, which costs a lot of money, certainly then, you have to be allowed to do it. And it has to be made in a particular context. So if I had some of the freedoms in the 60s and 70s that you don't have now, it's the opposite of what I've been saying about the technology. You have opportunities now with the technology that I would only dreamt about in the 60s and 70s. This is the other way around. Because in the 60s and 70s, the BBC was an organisation that within certain limits loved the creative act, thought it was there for a wider purpose than just getting a big audience for everything. And there was a little bit of room to breathe. And I took every opportunity that was offered. Now, there is only one criterion, and that is there a profit in it? Will this film make a profit? And everywhere but the BBC is based on ads. What you do if you make a film now for television is you deliver an audience to the advertiser. That is your job. And if you can't do that job, then they don't want you. But the technology has even changed the political and social system within which you work. It is now globalized like every other business. Good and bad, a mixture of the two. But now we have Netflix. And whereas the BBC will be pushed to put up £500,000 an hour, the Crown, which is about to open by Netflix, entirely financed by them, is £5 million an hour. And it's going worldwide. So there are more places to go, but a narrower range of things you can make. As I say, you can work on the internet. So if you're looking at a TV drama series, or looking at a single film for television, or even looking at any film made in this country for under about $5 million, you have to also think about the political and social context within which it was made, and the technological possibilities that were open to it. Or otherwise you won't really understand. It'll be a bit of sort of empty space. Where are we? Let's start
about
talking.
About 10 minutes more, and then you can have some questions.
No, I want to hear from this one. They're all looking a bit suspicious. And, have a go.
Does anyone want to start off with a question?
The first one is always the bravest. Thank you.
Governor in the back there.
Thank you.
Watched Kathy come home last night again, but I forgot.
You watch what?
Kathy come home.
Oh yeah.
I recently read a quote from Loach that basically said, Germany Year Zero and Rome Open City were his favourite films.
Could you say that again?
The question was that he saw Ken Loach said that Rome Open City was one of his favourite films.
I just wondered how influenced you were at the time by the filmmakers,
That's fine, absolutely. Well, Ken and I have very similar tastes in many ways, and we met in the 64, 65, and we were joined at the hip very quickly and for a long time, and he's still one of my oldest friends, and we're political comrades and so on. So his taste in films and the influences would be very similar. I love Bicycle Thieves, made in Italy on location just after the war. We were interested in the Czech and Eastern European cinema in the 60s and 70s, closely observed trains and those kind of films. I was very influenced by, not by Jean-Luc Godard, who I think is a wanker. Well, we did a film with him, and I knew him, and that's a considered judgment, and a kind one. But Raoul Coutard, his cameraman and operator, in Breathless did the most wonderful things, wonderful at the time, in a feature film, and that was really inspirational. And gave me a lot of ideas. The reason why that's an important question I've just been asked is that none of us come out of nowhere. We're all influenced. We all borrow and steal, and we steal without knowing it. Sometimes we steal and do know it, and call it an homage, by other people. You know, we don't suddenly wake up one morning and say, I think we'll do this. I mean, we might do, but the reason you're saying that is because a whole lot of other people before you have influenced you. And those are some of the things that influenced me and the colleagues I've pulled around me. So I suppose my taste has been very narrow. And I don't believe that it's the only way to make films. The word film is like the word writing. You can write about anything in all sorts of styles, and the same with film. And I've never criticized other people's styles or what they want to make films about, providing I get a chance to do it my way. And so I've planned a single narrow funnel, which might have been narrowing for me, but I've spent a lifetime trying to learn how to do that. Let me say just one word too, in coming out of some of those films, about form and content. They're not different. They're two sides of the same coin. The form is the content, and the content is the form. And we separate them out in order to see things a bit more clearly, but we must never think that they're separate. My ambition from the very beginning of starting to produce was this. I wanted, and the BBC and then Granada in those days were the only possible avenues for me. My ambition was that I wanted the people I came from, ordinary working class people, I wanted to put them on the screen in all their dignity, as truthfully as I could, and not have them patronized by posh people who were just either thought they were amusing or they were afraid of them. I wanted to do it the other way around. And of course, because I had and have a political agenda, I wanted to use that as well. So we'd be spending our lives, whenever we had the chance, making revolutionary, democrat, socialist films. They're making no bones about it. Somebody said to me in the 70s, your phone is tapped. I said, good boy, what do they want to tap my phone for? Of course they're not. If they want to know about my politics, I'll tell them. I mean, they're on the screen. What do they want to tap my phone for? And we found a form, a way of working, which seemed to us to suit that. I was told by some cineasts in the 70s and since that to use that distilled naturalism, or what they call realism, was a big mistake, because you will never put forward your political views successfully if you use an old form like that. And I said, you don't know my Uncle Fred, the milkman. If we used another form, he'd never watch it. And I'm trying to reach out to people. So the form and the content that you choose if you want to make films, or you use when you watch films, make sure you don't make such a distinction between them that you see them as separate categories. One is informing the other.
Another question?
Thank you for that question. Sir?
Alan here.
Sir?
I went to see I, Daniel Blake last week, and we're having a discussion in class this week. I think it links to what you're just saying. I would Daniel Blake go and see I, Daniel Blake, in the cinema, because where it's shown in Sheffield, it's quite a niche kind of student to academic environment, and I feel nowadays the order of people that I thought looked really well putting that on screen, but they won't see the film. And why do you think that is, if you agree with that?
Well, I don't know. I'll be speculating just like you're speculating. It is a problem if you make art films, as it were, that only play in select cinemas, that you play to a certain kind of audience. And the people who will go to that film will be people who've seen things directed by Ken before, and so they will tend to be fairly close to him politically. So the danger is that you're preaching to the converted, and people go to have their feelings reinforced. It is a problem, but it's difficult to know how to get out of that problem. I've always, one of the reasons I tried not to work in the cinema is I didn't like how pretentious and precious the art film world was. But if you want to work in the cinema, then it's a bit difficult to find an alternative. If you make huge budget movies, you will probably get a much bigger release and get a lot of different kinds of people going to see it. But the studio won't allow you to do and say things like Paul Laverty and Ken said in I, Daniel Blake. So I agree with you, but I don't know a way out of it. We did have a way out in the 60s and 70s. I mean, it was difficult, and I was only on the air, for instance, for 6 hours a year amongst the thousands and thousands of hours. But we got big audiences. We got 12, 15 million people watching a film. And those weren't just people who agreed with us politically. They were the broad mass of the audience. Now, that is great if you can get it, but these days it's difficult to get it, and television doesn't get those audiences anyway. So you are constrained and put in boxes. It is a problem. It's a problem on the internet as well, no doubt, because who's going to find your film? But you still have to make them and get them shown as widely as you can.
Question?
Yeah.
question here?
Yes,
not so much a question, but something else on that. They did show I, Daniel Blake as the secret screening film. I don't know how many cinemas that's at, but people pay for a ticket and it's £5, and they don't know what they're going to see.
And also the fact that the tickets were cheap. I think that was a great initiative on the part of 16 Films, and certainly would widen the audience. And actually, going to the pictures now is quite expensive. I mean, certainly down in London, watching anything in London is expensive. Even Arsenal supporter going, and you go to Arsenal, it's more expensive than going to the opera at Covent Garden, probably. Probably a better show, but it's difficult. I mean, people on ordinary wages or no wages. These are very big difficulties. So that was a great initiative. So let's hope it continues. Sure. Yes.
I saw the free screening and it was completely full of people that stereotype of working class people. But also, I was going to ask, what do you think of the film? You remember quite sad when you said no films ever change anything. Do you think this one can change anything?
You put me in a difficulty because, first of all, I have an iron policy that I never, ever comment on anybody else's work. I'm not a critic. Also, these are my friends. And as I said, Ken is a mate.
And then what do you think, like the climate is better to change?
Well, yes, I mean, if you haven't seen it, please go, by the way. But, that's the interesting bit of that question to me. That films do exist in a social context, and sometimes you make a film and it will just disappear without trace because it just doesn't catch the moment. But I think Daniel Blake is catching a moment now. I think there is... Maybe I'm just being optimistic again, but I think that in the last year or two there has been a sort of shift in the pendulum of politics. Remember, Harold Wilson said, a week is a long time in politics, but politics is a long game. And I do feel there's a lot of people now thinking it went too far, and they're feeling a bad conscience about it all. And Daniel Blake is out just at that moment. And it can have some influence if it just catches the right moment. And I think it might have done. So let's hope so anyway.
Do you have another question? I saw two hands go up. Yeah, Rachel?
Yeah, could you say a bit more about your relationship with Barry Hines?
I'd be happy to. As you know, Barry died last year. He'd been my friend for 50 years. I'll choke up talking about it if I don't care. He was a good man. I first met Barry in the middle 60s. I'd heard about him. There was a radio producer in Leeds called Alfred Bradley. He worked out of Leeds. And Alfred just tipped the wink about this lad. So I read his first novel called The Blinder, which was about a lad who could have been a professional footballer. And Barry Hines, of course, as you know, he had a trial and he could have been a professional footballer. In fact, he played football for the English Grammar Schools team. He was good. Then he went to Loughborough in the end, trying to be a teacher, as you know. And I thought there was something in this book, so I asked him if I could meet him, and he came down to London, and I met him at the Television Centre. And as soon as I met him, I knew he'd get on. He looked at you. He had his bright blue eyes were like headlamps, and you looked at him, and you knew he was going to be straight with you. And the two-faced sons I was having to work with at the time down there, it was really refreshing, and we got on immediately. And I said to him, would you like to write a Wednesday play? And he said, no. which brought me back a bit. I said, oh, why? He said, well, there's a book going around in my head. And I want to go and write that. And he immediately went up in my estimation because he would have been paid quite a nice fee for a Wednesday play and for just a few months' work. And I knew a book had taken a year or two. And what would probably going to be a literary novel, I mean, it wasn't in the end, but he would have paid, he would have got very little for it, certainly as an advance. But he still wanted to do it. So I said, well, I'm sorry, I respect that. Good luck with the book. And when he finished it, maybe I could have a look at it. And I more or less forgot about it then and got on with other productions and stuff I was doing. And about 18 months later, 12 or 18 months later, his agent, Sheila Lemon, sent me to this manuscript, came out of my desk. And I read it. I started to read it, and I put everything else aside and read it all, one go, and said, we're going to make it. I was that certain, and I gave it to Ken, because I knew Ken was just right for it. Ken was always very good with actors, and particularly young actors. So that's how it started. And there's a whole chapter in my book about Kez, how it was almost impossible to raise the money, and then almost impossible to get it released. I don't know, it's a miracle, really, all the way through. But we came up to Barnsley, and Barry was with us all the time, which is what I always do. And helping us and guiding us and giving advice and talking to Ken and me all the way through. And then I worked with him after that. We did four films together. You've probably all read A Kestrel for a Knave, and you may have even seen Kes. I think he's going to live on as a writer. Because he's so honest about that world, and he so lived in that world. He didn't want to go to any other world. I mean, as I said at his funeral, he had been abroad. I mean, he'd been to Sheffield, and he'd even been to London, but he only cared about Hoyland Common near Barnsley, and he really knew it. And when he wrote about it, he wrote it from the inside. He wasn't some writer who comes and researches and say, well, I'll write that. Interesting, I'll write about that. He was right inside it. And because of his dad and his granddad, and everybody in that village, more or less, were miners, he loved the mining community. And he wrote about them with understanding and deep affection. And he was also poetic as a writer. But his writing was so plain and so unaffected. And he didn't write lines which said, aren't I being poetic? People read the books and don't see it. But his images were sometimes so present in your mind, but you just read the words. For instance, I remember a line in Kestrel for a Knave. He writes about a little toddler on a tricycle, which is, you know, going down the pavement. And he said, his legs were going like bees' wings. And you suddenly see this, you can hardly see the legs going. And that you see that boy on the pavement, and he's got lots of just simple images like that, which are unpretentious but take you into the scene. Anyway, so I'm clearly a fan of his writing as well as he was a good friend. And whatever he wrote, you hardly had to turn into a screenplay. It was all there. And you know, the story is true that when he wrote A Kestrel for a Knave, he went back and he'd write a scene in the school, and he'd go and he'd read it to the class, this draft scene, and then and the kid would say, "Oh no, we wouldn't do that, sir. We do this. Nobody say that." We don't. And so they were giving him notes, and he'd go and rewrite it according to what the kids had told him. Ken and I and Barry had a screenplay credit on that, but you know, it was a cutting job, really. It was a cut and paste job. It's all there in the book. So people are very proud of him around here, and they should be.
A question?
So,
you've just said there wasn't much to it, but I was curious to hear about some of the processes of adaptation from when you got the manuscript and taken something from a novel to being filmed, and some of the creative decisions that are behind that kind of process.
Well, first of all, you can't film a novel, because if you did, it'd be hours and hours and hours long. And secondly, you can be more discursive in a novel, can't you? I mean, a film doesn't give you any escape. You start watching it, and you watch it in linear form for 90 minutes or 100 minutes or whatever it is, and there's the end. So the narrative rules have to be different, and they're tighter. In a film, you set up a protagonist, and there's a problem of one sort or another, and see them try to defeat that. But even if you have subplots, there has to be clarity all the way through. Whereas in a lot of books, certainly in that genre, you can take your time. We had to make decisions about what to cut and how to link events up so that the narrative would stay in the air. Because if the narrative collapses ever, or you go become too discursive, and you lose an audience, with a film it's very difficult to get them back. It varies from film to film, of course. The European art film does allow you to meander around a bit. You don't win awards unless it's a bit boring here and there. A Hollywood movie has very, very tight rules about the narrative drive. And it's one of the few things I wish I learned in Hollywood that I wish I'd known years before. For instance, let me give you a for instance. You get really experienced screenwriters in Hollywood, and they will say, the CIA rule is important. I said, what's that? And they'd say, need to know. Because if you watch a really effective Hollywood movie, just looking at it technically, there's virtually no exposition. Whereas you look at a lot of European art films, and they spend minute after minute after minute after minute with the characters introducing themselves to each other and telling you about themselves. Well, a movie isn't a social occasion where you have to introduce people to each other before you get on with the party. What a really smart Hollywood screenwriter will do is start the action, pose a problem, and they don't give you any information until you as an audience absolutely demand it, and then they'll drop some in, and then you don't even know it's exposition, for instance. I wish I'd known that 10 or 15 years before, because we used to make films, and I used to learn through, where every 10 minutes the action would stop for a political speech. So different films have different rules. But in case, it was just an editing job, really. There's no original writing in it, in the screenplay, or virtually none, because Barry is so visual, isn't he, and the characters are there. And a lot of the dialogue is actually there in the book.
Question?
Yes,
I would like to talk to you about Up the Junction. I saw it a few years ago, and in light of you coming here, I watched it a couple of days ago. And I'd just like to talk about your involvement in it, because I understand your personal experiences and what you've been through with it. But I would just like to talk to you about what it was like to make, and so forth.
Well, Up the Junction was one of the first things on the way to being a producer. I was a story editor, script editor, story editor, on a series called The Wednesday Play, produced by James McTaggart. And I wasn't a producer then. And I got this book, actually, Ken found the book, and he showed it to me. And Ken and I were getting closer and closer because of the kind of, the way we wanted to make film. And I could see it just like Ken could see it, but there's no way the BBC would have done it for what it was saying and also for the structure. And James McTaggart went on holiday, so I saw my chance and put it into production, just as an ordinary Wednesday play. And when he came back from holiday, of course he went apeshit, because he read it and said, but there's no story here. I mean, this isn't a film. This is, we can't make this. But then he realised we had to make it, because it was towards the end of that Wednesday play run and we had nothing in reserve. So we either made it and it went out on that Wednesday after it was made and put together, or he would go to the boss, Sidney Newman, and say, you're going to have a blank screen or repeat that week because we don't have any. So he reluctantly said, well, you'll have to carry on with it. He said, but I'm not producing it, you're the producer. And I refused that because I didn't want anybody to say that I'd sneakily gone behind his back in order to cheat and get a producer credit. Also, he was a friend and a very good man to me, and I wouldn't do that to him anyway. But you will have noted that this friend of mine, I went behind his back, didn't tell the BBC what we were doing, snatched a few days filming out of the film department in order to do a particular film. So that's me lying and cheating the institution and one of my best friends. And I admit that that's what I did. It was so important to me that we made that film. Steele's Abortion Law Reform Act was fighting its way through Parliament at that time during that year. And if anybody bothers to read my memoir, they'll see why the backstreet abortion that Ruby goes through, which is a scene that graphically shown in that film, was so important to me. I won't this afternoon talk about the details of that because it's still too upsetting for me. You've seen the film recently, and during Ruby's abortion, which I hope is pretty graphic and not easy to watch, we had a voiceover quietly, authoritatively giving the statistics of how many women die, at that time die, from illegal abortions. And he just goes through it. That man, Don Grant, was my GP. And he'd spent most of his life actually delivering babies. He was an obstetrician too, and he really knew what he was talking about. It was one of our few excursions into the Brecht alienation effect, I suppose. I had a flirtation with Brecht, love-hate relationship with Brick. So it cemented Ken and me, and it was something that I knew we had to get on the screen. So, yeah. And they did well. I'm glad you watched it.
Another question? Rina?
Yes.
You know, because we've got so many opportunities to make films nowadays with like all the funding that's available and that sort of thing, do you think it's necessarily easier to make more of an impact in the political climate if you want to make an impactful film in the same way as it would in the 1960s?
Is it easier or more difficult now, do you think? I think it's more difficult. The political climate now has changed, has it not, from when I was young. Everything now is individualised and commercialised, and the whole tone and temper of our environment is right wing compared with the environment I was in, which did have the possibilities of political debate. And there's a closing off of opportunities, isn't there? There are more opportunities now to make films, but it's the kind of films you're allowed to make is the problem. Which is why I'm saying that if you want to break out of that and say what you want to say, whatever your politics are, right, left, centre, or anything, then the internet's there. They haven't closed that down yet. I think they'd like to, and they're going to do their best by making us afraid of pederasts and terrorists. But they're going to find that difficult to close down the internet because it's very useful to them. And there is something about technological change that drives all before it. So at the moment, with YouTube and all the other places you can do your films, nobody's going to stop you. You're not going to do big budget films. You're not going to have the Cossacks coming over the hill and have a big cast. But what I've found is if the screenplay is really tight and works, and that costs nothing if you do it yourself, writing is the only job in our business they can't stop you doing. If that screenplay works and the canvas is small, you can make a film for virtually and you can say anything you want to do about the world and human relationships with three or four people or two or three people in a room, which you can do at home. So there are more opportunities because of technology, and there are fewer opportunities because of the political and economic change. And you've just got to recognize where you are and what the situation is. You've got to live in reality and say, okay, if this is exactly where we are, how will I take advantage of that? It's no use saying, wouldn't it be good if? You know, you've got to live in the present. I quite like it, actually, while we were. The constrictions would be quite arduous sometimes, but I just revel in the creative freedom. Because I've spent my life fighting executives and political censorship, and sometimes being driven off the air, sometimes having things banned, desperately trying to raise money to make things. And that's the exhausting bit of it.
Another question? Yeah, we've got one here.
I read an interview the other day with David Bradley saying that every time he watches Kez, he can't quite finish it. I was just wondering if you still have that emotional connection with the film and specifically with the ending.
I don't have any emotional connection with any film in that sense. The problem is, as soon as you've finished a film, whatever job you've done on it, well, for me anyway, I'll then watch it a week or two after, a year or two after, 10 years after. And my reaction is, oh, shit. I know how to make that now. But it's too late. Because all you can see is what's wrong with it. All you can see is, why on earth did we do that? Why did we recast that? You know, and you keep asking those questions and beating yourself up. That's the opposite of the ones you never got made. The ones you couldn't raise the money for. They're perfect. Because they're still playing in your head. And I tell you, they're brilliant. I'll tell you, they're brilliant. There's nothing wrong with them. So I don't even enjoy watching stuff from the past, really. Also, I can't really watch films now without standing away from them. I never get involved with them anymore. I just think, oh, why did they make that decision with the screenplay? Why did they cast that person? So you get a distance from it. A bit like that with novels now.
Do you have a question as well?
He doesn't ask. What's your relationship with kind of Mike Lee? And what's his thoughts on how he kind of worked with his actors? Obviously more workshop style compared to Loach, who kind of took a boy from Barnsley and kind of let him down to what he knew and maybe the limitations that you saw.
Well, I worked with Mike early on. In a little film he did for the BBC called Hard Labour. And I just thought he had something and an original way of going about it, and he should have a chance. So with that film, I virtually just gave him some resources that I'd got from the BBC and protected him and said, carry on. I didn't. That's all I did, and he's the lad has done well in subsequent years. It's another way of looking at it. It's unless you have a worldwide reputation, which Mike has now, it's extremely difficult to get any films made, because what you're saying to the financier is, I don't know what this film's about, but what I want to do is to cast, I don't know how many actors, and pay them for 10 or 12 weeks. And at the end of that, we might, and improvise with them, at the end of that, we might, there might be a film for us to make. Now, that's not a very attractive proposition, unless they've seen you do lots before. And that's more or less exactly the way Mike works. It's an approach, and he's done very well with it, and he's very skillful with it. I wasn't tempted. I wanted to stay in my foreign, but I think it's he should be allowed to make films, and I'm glad he is making films. And also, he's a very good example of someone with immense determination and self-belief. Because when he was starting out, determined to work in that way, you wouldn't have given him much of a chance, really, when faced with people who might or might not put the money up. And he's never deviated. He's never said, oh, well, in that case, I'll do it a bit differently to get the money. There's a way he wants it to work, and that's the way he's always worked. And that's taken, that takes a lot of resolve. So, good for him.
Got time.
By the way, his next film, which won't start for a year or two, is a big, big film. It's the Peterloo Massacre in the early 19th century. So that is going to be, I think he's more or less got the money for it. That's going to be quite a big period job. Interesting.
I think Sue's got a question.
Go
with Sue and then we'll have Aaron for another 10 minutes. Yeah, no problem.
Just coming on from that, talking about the Peterloo Massacre and what you were saying about Orgreave, I wondered if you thought there was any point or possibility of making another film about Orgreave. I know people have done it, but one for now, in the light of what's happened recently.
Well, I'm not in the film business anymore. I gave it up a few years ago because there were some books going around in my head and I wanted to get them out of my head. And I've done 50 years of it and I wanted a change. But if I was in the film business now, that's something I would be trying to do. Because I think there is a terrific, forget the politics for the moment, there is a terrific film to be made about Orgreave. Or a miniseries for television or a feature film. Because Arthur himself was a heck of a personality, I can tell you personally. And also, he wasn't a hero, he was a flawed hero, which makes it more interesting dramatically. And the forces of the state were very subtle and very powerful, and the miners themselves were, I have to tell you, there were some immense characters, and particularly their wives. So you've got everything going for you. And now you're in a situation where they still won't look at it. And they looked at Hillsborough because that could not involve the government. There was no trace back. South Yorkshire Police could take the rap. The government wasn't involved with Hillsborough. The government was very involved in Orgreave and that strike. And my guess is that Amber Rudd gave her reasons, which are pretty shallow reasons, because they don't want to go there. Because if you started one of those big Hillsborough inquiries about Orgreave, eventually there'd be a danger that it would all be traced back to Thatcher's number 10 and Ridley and all her Tebbit and all the people behind her who are still anonymous, and the connection between state violence, which is what the police were perpetrating, and the elected government of the day, I don't think they're too keen on that connection to be made. I would be happy to make that connection and ask them to prove that it wasn't true or deny it, which they would. So there's an amazing opportunity to do a one-off film for the cinema or two or three parties for television. But I wouldn't give anybody too big a chance of raising the money because it would be quite expensive. Mm-hmm. And I can't see anybody wanting to do it, unfortunately. You can try.
I think, Aaron, you have one.
You can't
question?
Do that for the internet, you know, it's too big. Sorry. So,
last question then.
I'm only 20 and I can remember seeing people like Jimmy McGovern and Paul Abbott on TV. But I don't know, in the last 10 years it just kind of feels different, almost like a smokescreen of history. I just wondered, do you think social realism on prime time TV is a bygone era?
Well, it looks like it, doesn't it, at the moment. They want escapist drama about kings and queens with costumes, and international entertainment. But one of the duties of the culture in this country, as well as making stuff for the world, is to reflect, to be part of the national conversation. In fact, that ought to be the BBC's main preoccupation, as well as all the other TV companies. And that seems to be lacking. We also, in addition to that, have a climate in this country now which is London-centric, so that all culture is filtered through the sensibilities of London. And you have to go to London to raise money to do anything. You have to live in London, or been born and bred in the outskirts of London. If you want to start as a filmmaker, you can probably live at home if you're from London. If you're from Rotherham, you have to go there and find a way of actually existing in order to learn to be a film, or be a filmmaker. So this London-centric thing is very important because it breeds people who think that everyone living north of Watford lives in a cave. Even Channel 4, which is one of the better ones, talks about our northern correspondent. Well, what about our southern correspondent? Right? So it's all foreign up here. It's foreign. That means that when they, not just drama, when they have a story from the north, they'll send Felicity, who probably comes from Roehampton, who will go up north to look at the natives. That's you. A bit like a visiting anthropologist. Aren't they quaint? And she'll do a charming story, perhaps, about these lovely people. Utterly patronizing. Or you'll get a harder news story, documentary, realism, where everybody's a sponger and a scrounger and they're all on benefits, right? And they're all ugly. You know, and that would go, oh yeah, that feeds people's prejudices. Worse than it was when I started. When I said, we're not going to have this class patronage. We're going to put people on the screen in their dignity and understand them and see life from their point of view. You don't get that anymore. You're right. Well, that's not going to change. That culture's not going to change. That attitude's not going to change until the politics of this country change. You've got everything stems from the political atmosphere about what is allowed and not allowed. Don't believe this is a free country any more than America is a free country or Stalinist Russia was a free country. They've just got very different ways of disciplining your so-called freedom. They say here there's not an audience for it, or people wouldn't be interested in that, or we can't sell ads with that. You're perfectly free to do anything you want, but what's the difference between that and those filmmakers in Czechoslovakia having to duck and dive to get their film ran past the party? Freedom is a very relative concept, but they put it to you as though it's absolutely British. It ain't. So there's a long way to go, and I'm getting on, so it's about time you start the revolution.
Great note on which to end. Thank you very much, Tony. Come back. We've got to get you off to the showroom now for your next speaking engagement.